Welcome to the Calvary Ministry Program with Pastor Don Gulden. For more information about this ministry, visit our website calvaryministry.org. This program is viewer supported. We are located at 150 Golden Road, Jacksonville, North Carolina. Our email contact is dongulden@gmail.com. And now today's message.
Good morning, folks. This is Pastor Don Gulden. I'm so glad that you're here with us today. I think that you're going to enjoy the message that we have today. We'll be continuing in our series of sermons and studies on the book of the Revelation as written by the Apostle John in the first Christian century between 90 and 95 CE. You recall, too, just for general refreshment, that he was at this time a political prisoner of the Emperor of Rome, Domitian, and he had been on the isle as a prisoner for a number of years. I can't help but think about this man who is 90-plus year old, and he's a political prisoner living under the harsh circumstances of a prisoner of Rome on this island of Patmos. The emperor must have been certain that he would eliminate the word of John that was contrary to the emperor worship that he wanted for himself. I'm sure that Domitian was sure that if he put this old man in prison, he would die. And absolutely the opposite thing happens. John thrives in prison, and he writes under the divine inspiration of God this book that we call the Revelation of Jesus the Christ. It is a book for all the ages. It is a book that completely sums up all that we know need to know about God, God's kingdom, and the glory of God as it was manifested on this earth in the Lord Jesus the Christ. Last time we were in chapter 3 of the Revelation, and we're still there looking at this church in Philadelphia. Now, another point, Philadelphia, though it was a small church, it was the only one of the letters of the seven churches that he writes to where he finds no fault with them. Contrary to any fault, what he does say is all types of good and positive things about him in the letter that he gives. We'll be going into verse 9 today. We'll be going into verse 9 of chapter 3, looking at the letter from Jesus to the church at Philadelphia. Jesus begins there in verse 9 of chapter 3, his letter to the church in Philadelphia. He says, "Behold, I will make them of the synagogue of Satan, which say they are Jews and are not, but do lie. Behold, I will make them to come and worship before thy feet and to know that I have loved thee." Now, as we study these last few sermons and verses over the next several weeks to the church at Philadelphia, we're going to find that here in the church of Philadelphia, the letter to it, Jesus makes a total of four promises to this little church that was continuing to be strong in carrying forth the message and the gospel, the good news of the Lord Jesus the Christ. Today, this is the first promise that we have from him to examine. And again, I will read the verse. It says in verse 9, "Behold, I will make them of the synagogue of Satan." Now, let's begin to understand what Jesus is saying here. "Behold, I will make them of the synagogue of Satan, which say they are Jews and are not, but do lie. Behold, I will make them to come and worship before thy feet and to know that I have loved thee." This is the first promise. And Jesus says that there are those in the church at Philadelphia who are literally of the synagogue of Satan, which say they are Jews and are not. Let's begin to understand what Jesus is saying. Now, I would tell you, too, that almost all of the earlier followers of Jesus, those that heard the good news and received it and put it into their heart and their mind and their life, that they identified Jesus the Christ as Jesus the Christ. He was the promised Messiah. He was the one that had been prophesied, even though he had come from that small town of Nazareth, and that was prophesied as well. He was the one who had come to deliver the good news, to free them from oppression, to heal them of their wounds, to relieve their suffering. He was the one that came in the name of the Lord to give them peace and to give them an understanding and an access to God like had never been given before in all of the ages. This synagogue of Satan. Now, as I said, almost all of the earlier followers of Jesus were Jews. And that tendency continued here to this little church of Philadelphia. They had a large number of Jewish members who had seen Jesus as the Messiah and now called themselves Christians. Jesus says that there are many among that group that call themselves Christians and who say that they are Jews, but they are not. What is Jesus talking about? Well, in order to begin to understand what Jesus is saying, we need to go back to the book of Deuteronomy. And if these are the writings of Moses, and we need to look at what God gave the great prophet and spiritual leader of Israel, Moses, to say. And if we go to Deuteronomy chapter 10 and verse 12 as a beginning point, this is what God inspired Moses to write to the people of Israel. Now keep in mind that at this time when this is being written, Moses is an old man. He has been leading them now for over 40 years and they are approaching the promised land. And Moses preaches this sermon and gives this message to the people of Israel. And now, Israel, what does the Lord thy God require of thee but to fear the love thy God? And that word fear means to reverence the Lord thy God, to walk in all God's ways and to love him and to serve the Lord thy God with all thy heart and with all thy soul. That word that they use there for love, when Moses says that you are to love God and to serve the Lord thy God, that word there is ahab in the Hebrew language. And it means man's total commitment and love to the commandments of and the will of Almighty God. Now, what does that consist of? Does that consist in a bunch of ritual practices? If we go down to verse 16, God inspires Moses to write, circumcise therefore the foreskin of your heart and be no more stiff-necked. There's another writing in the Bible that says, what does the Lord thy God require of thee but to walk humbly with thy Lord and to obey his will? The word here is from Moses. He tells them, yes, you have submitted to the ritual practice of circumcision. And he says, that's good that you have done that. But he says, understand that your relationship with God is a spiritual relationship. Therefore, circumcise, therefore, the foreskin of your heart. You shall reverence the Lord your God, to walk in all God's ways, and to love him, and to serve thy Lord thy God with all thy heart and with all thy soul. Circumcise, therefore, the foreskin of your heart. Come to God in spirit and in truth, and live your life according to the will of God. Now, there's another part here that becomes important. God tells Moses, tell the people of Israel. There's another thing. Love ye therefore the stranger. Love ye therefore the stranger. Now, apparently the problem that was taking place there in the church at Philadelphia was that there were Jews that came in and said they wanted to be Christians, and the congregation there, the little church at Philadelphia, accepted them in. But when they came in, they wanted to change what the Christian community there had been led to believe and do by the will of God. They wanted to bring in all these ritualistic practices and legalistic practices that would keep the gospel from growing and spreading according to the will of God, what God had ordained for this church. Jesus tells them, be mindful that there are these that say they are Jews, but they are not. You see, the Jews were supposed to have a vision to reach out to strangers. Isn't that what we just read in Deuteronomy? There in verse 16 of chapter 10. They were supposed to reach out to strangers. They were supposed to evangelize. They were supposed to do exactly what Jonah had done. Jonah went to the king of Nineveh, and as a consequence, not only the king of Nineveh, but all of Nineveh was converted. What an amazing thing. But you can only do that with the power of the gospel and to preach that God is salvation. Salvation is of God. That was the message that Jonah preached, and that was the message that this little church at Philadelphia was putting out regarding salvation. But there were those in there, according to what Jesus says, that did not want to see the gospel to be spread. Jesus tells them, there are those that say they are Jews, and they are not. And he says that the message that they tried to get people to hear is nothing but a lie, because it does not teach the spiritual circumcision, but it teaches only the physical circumcision. Now, if we go to the book of Matthew, and I would ask you if you would to turn with me there, Matthew chapter 23. Turn with me there if you would. And you say, well, what types of lies were these ones that called themselves Jews and also wanted to be part of the Christian community? What type of lies were they teaching, or what types of lies were they trying to get the Church of Philadelphia to compromise to? Matthew chapter 23. And beginning in verse 10, Jesus is talking directly to the Pharisees and Sadducees, the scholars, the doctors of the law, those who were interpreters, those who were the writers of the laws, the scribes. And he says to them in chapter 23 of Matthew, beginning in verse 13, "But woe unto you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for you shut up the kingdom of heaven against men, for ye neither go in yourselves, neither suffer ye them that are entering to go in." Isn't that what Jesus is saying? Those who called themselves Jews within the congregation at Philadelphia were literally teaching and preaching a message that was shutting the door to the kingdom of heaven and misleading men who were anxious to seek the will of God in their lives. He calls them hypocrites because they're doing exactly opposite what God wants them to do. God said in Deuteronomy, "Reach out to the stranger and live your life in reverence and love toward God." They were not doing that. Verse 14, "A woe again to Pharisees," and he calls them hypocrites again. Verse 15, "Woe unto the scribes and Pharisees," he calls them hypocrites again. And he talks there about the misleading. He says they want to make proselytes. He says that would be the strangers that are mentioned in Deuteronomy, bringing them into the belief of the one true God. That was a proselyte. And he says even the ones that they make proselytes in the legal sense, they hurt them with false teaching and false doctrine. Verse 16, he calls those same scribes and Pharisees blind guides, the fourth woe unto them. Verse 23, Jesus calls the scribes and the Pharisees hypocrites again. He says, "Judgment will be upon you." Verse 25, the sixth woe upon them. He calls them hypocrites, the scribes and the Pharisees. Verse 27, the seventh woe upon them. Woe unto the scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites. He says, even so in verse 28, "Even so you also outwardly appear righteous unto men." These that called themselves Christians, the Jews that were part of the Philadelphia congregation, they wanted to appear righteous on the outside unto men. But Jesus says to them here in verse 28, and it's what he's telling the church at Philadelphia, "Within they are full of hypocrisy and iniquity." The eighth woe unto this crowd, who called themselves Jews, but they are not, they lie. Jesus again calls them hypocrites. And he says in verse 33, he calls them serpents. Serpents. Now, the devil is called a serpent. Verse 33, Jesus says to these Pharisees and these Sadducees and these others of his day, who have not the Spirit of God, but only the legal appearance of righteousness. He says to them, "You are serpents. You are a generation of vipers." Now he uses that term of a viper. A viper is a small snake that hides and was commonly found back in those days anywhere in almost any home they could be found. whether they were poor or whether they were wealthy. These small snakes could sneak in and hide in a corner, could hide in a crevice, could hide under the grain basket. And they had a poisonous bite to them. Jesus says to these Pharisees, these hypocrites, these false Jews, "You serpents, you generation of vipers, how can you escape the damnation of hell?" 8 woes that Jesus pronounced upon them. And here again, Jesus warns this church of Philadelphia about this synagogue of Satan, as he calls them. The old serpent, the deceiver, he warns this synagogue at Philadelphia against those who say they are Jews and they are not. They lie because they only have the legal form, the ritualistic form, and they do not have the spirit and the truth of God within them. He says there at the close, and remember, this is the first of 4 promises that Jesus makes to this little church at Philadelphia. And he says there in the close of verse 9, "I will make them to come and worship before thy feet and to know that I have loved thee." Jesus says, yes, this evil, this threat is within your church. I've identified them. He says, but I want you to know that you will have victory over them because of your strength and the fact that you have kept my word and that you have not denied my name. He says, I will make them to come and worship before thy feet. I want to give you some verses for this second part of that. And that is this phrase, come and worship before thy feet. If we go to the book of Isaiah, now Isaiah was one of the great major prophets of the Old Testament. And in chapter 45 and verse 22 of Isaiah, these words are written, the very words of God. God proclaims that unto me, that me being Almighty God, every knee shall bow and every tongue shall swear. That's in Isaiah chapter 45 and verse 22. I want you to transition now to the writings of Paul. And Paul, who knew these words, had memorized them. Paul writes to the Romans in chapter 14 and verse 11. Paul declares, "As I live, saith the Lord, every knee shall bow to me and every tongue shall confess to God." Doesn't that sound like exactly what Jesus is promising this little church here at Philadelphia? He says there, I will read to you again, "I will make them to come and worship before thy feet and to know that I have loved you." Paul writes again in the book of Philippians, written to the church at Philippi, chapter 2 and verses 10 and 11. Listen to what Paul had to say. Now, keep in mind that Paul wrote these things that we have read to the Romans and now to the church at Philippi. Paul was a former Pharisee. When Jesus gave those 8 woes in Jerusalem to the Pharisees, Paul was just a young man. He was probably in his late 20s, but he was already destined for great things because of his singular intelligence, his academic ability, and he had been taught by the very finest of the scholars available in Jewish teaching at that time, Shammai and Gamaliel. He was on a fast track to become one of the upper members of the Sanhedrin. He gave all of that up. And he writes this in his letter to the church at Philippi. He says that at the name of Jesus, listen to this. Now, this is the same man who participated in the stoning of the disciple Stephen unto Stephen's death. This is the same one undoubtedly who collaborated and who supported all the efforts by the Pharisees of the time when Jesus was conducting his ministry. This is the same Paul that collaborated with them, and supported all the efforts to eliminate this young rabbi from Nazareth, whom all the people ran to hear and to see and to be healed by. Listen to what Paul says in Philippians chapter 2, verses 10 and 11. Paul writes that at the name of Jesus, the same one he had persecuted early in his life, now he proclaims this, that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow, of things in heaven and things in earth and things under the earth. Verse 11. And that every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Paul understood that salvation is of God. Paul understood the power of salvation in Jesus the Christ. And Paul understood that Jesus the Christ is the very glory of God the Father. Now Jesus, there in closing, when he makes that first promise to the church at Philadelphia, there in closing he says, "Know that I have loved thee." If we turn now to the book of John, turn to the book of John with me, and we want to go to chapter 15, chapter 15, and verse 12. Jesus has this to say. Remember that we're talking about the love that Jesus had for this church at Philadelphia, the church whose very name means brotherly love. Chapter 15 of John, verse 12. Jesus says, "This is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you." Verse 17 of that same chapter, Jesus closes that short sermon that he gave to his disciples. He says, "These things I command you, that you love one another." Jesus completely brought the glory of God and the truth that salvation is of God to mankind. We have used this verse many times, John chapter 3 and verse 16. "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, and that whosoever believes in him will not perish, but will have eternal life. That was the love that Jesus gave there in that close of verse 9 to the church of Philadelphia. The very love of God, the very power of salvation. The very power of salvation. And what salvation can do to strengthen and empower our lives to live according to God's will. If you have never asked God to come into your life with the gift, the free gift, and the power of his salvation, I would ask you to take these few minutes and seconds in closing to say this simple prayer. God, I am a sinner. And I know, God, that my spirit cannot live except with the power of your spirit within me. God, I pray, forgive me of my sins, and in the name of Jesus the Christ, impart your salvation unto me. I pray, God, to be a child of yours. In the name of Jesus, amen.
Thank you for watching the Calvary Ministry Program with Pastor Don Gulden. For more information about this ministry, visit our website calvaryministry.org. This program is viewer supported. We are located at 150 Gulden Road, Jacksonville, North Carolina. Our email contact is dongulden@gmail.com.